Coming up, we're going to have a look on how you can centrally manage and onboard a wide range of resources such as Windows, Linux, and SQL servers, Kubernetes clusters, and even other resources as well. I'm here with Ryan Willis from the Azure Management Team to talk about how you can leverage and onboard resources to the Azure control plane.
Thanks for having me, Thomas. Glad to be here.
We talk to customers, obviously, about Azure Arc on onboarding resources to Azure to take advantage of the Azure control plane. Now, one of the things often comes up with architects who need to plan and manage these environments, they obviously know tools like Azure Policy or other management services, but they obviously need to outline their hybrid or multi-cloud environment so they can actually take advantage and organize their resources. Now, how can Azure Arc really help them?
So an Azure Arc resource is just like any other Azure resource. It's going to get registered in Azure Resource Manager, that central control plane where everything you have in Azure shows up and can be queried and managed. And so that means that all the standard organizational tools available to you in Resource Manager work for Arc resources too. So if you go onboard your Kubernetes clusters and your servers to Azure Arc, you'll get to pick what subscription, management group, resource group these resources end up in. And of course, you can use things like tags to help organize and keep track of which department owns these resources, what role they're serving. So yeah, it's really the same experience, and you just pick and choose where you want these Arc servers to show up.
So I cannot just use like management groups, subscriptions, and tagging and all that stuff for my Azure resources. I can really extend this to my on-premises or multi-cloud environment. So that is cool. The same thing is also, I get often questions by the security and compliance engineers to ask like, okay, so how can I leverage that? How can I leverage Azure Arc in that scenario?
Yeah, it's a good question. You know, from the compliance perspective, Azure Policy runs on Azure Resource Manager. So in order to evaluate a resource and know whether it's compliant, it has to know the resource exists. And that's really the benefit of Azure Arc, is by getting all your resources to show up in a single place, then things like Azure Policy can become aware of them and start enforcing your governance on those machines so that you get better information about, you know, what is currently running in your environment from a basic inventory perspective, as well as is the particular configuration of these machines or Kubernetes clusters or whatever resource you've onboarded, you know, as expected for that company's IT policy.
So IT administrators obviously, and we talk about that for a couple of times, can obviously take advantage of some of the Azure management services to manage the Azure resources, right? That is one part, obviously, of their job. The other one is actually to maybe onboard resources to the Azure control plane using Azure Arc. Can you explain a little bit about the role and how you onboard the resources to the Azure Arc control plane?
Absolutely. So all the Azure Arc products use kind of an agent-based architecture. So in order to make your resource show up in Azure Resource Manager, you'll first install an agent on that server or Kubernetes cluster, and then project it or really connect it into Azure Resource Manager, at which point it will show up and behave just like any other Azure resource. So the agent-based architecture helps us get a connection to each individual machine and start managing it just like we would an Azure resource.
So does that mean I need to obviously go out to deploy these agents. Does that mean I need full internet connectivity, or do I need to have some sort of inbound connectivity for that? Or how can I lock it down a little bit?
Yeah, that's a great question. And the answer really depends on each individual Arc product. So for Arc servers and Arc Kubernetes, these services are taking existing infrastructure and making it show up in Azure. So for the most part, they work in connected scenarios. Having a disconnected scenario won't allow us to project that resource into Azure. So it needs some sort of connection into Azure to be able to actually tell us what is currently happening on that machine and respond to things like policies and extension deployments that you make from Azure that will affect the machine running on-prem or in another cloud. That being said, all the connections are coming outbound from that machine over two well-known IP addresses over HTTPS connections. We document all of these in our documentation. If you are building firewall rules or have a proxy server in place that you need to grant access to our backend services. And for the really security conscious folks who don't want to connect these servers directly or indirectly to the public internet, we're working on Azure Arc Private Link Scope, which is actually going to let you send all the traffic that needs to go into Azure for that machine to be Azure Arc enabled over a VPN or express route connection directly into an Azure VNet without having to go over the public internet.
Oh, wow. That is awesome. Especially the part where, again, you can leverage Azure express route to actually get all that traffic over a secure, basically, connection to Azure. Now, that's awesome. So we spoke about, you told me how it works. Can we have a look on how you can actually onboard resources?
Definitely. Let's take a look at an example for Arc-enabled servers. All right, so we are here in the Azure portal. I'm going to head over to the Azure Arc server page, where you'll see a list of all my existing servers, but we're going to go ahead and add a new one. You're first presented with two options. You can either onboard a single server or multiple servers. And what's happening in this process is you're generating an installation script. So we'll guide you through a wizard asking you what subscription and resource group do you want to put this resource in? What region do you want to store the metadata about this server or Kubernetes cluster in Azure? What OS is it? And then lastly, you just need some form of authentication to be able to say, look, I'm allowed to register this resource in this particular resource group in Azure. For the at-scale deployment, when you're looking at production, we'll use a service principle typically for that. And so we'll guide you and make sure that you are able to select a service principle that has appropriate permissions. Every Arc service publishes built-in Azure Active Directory roles with least permission goals so that you can actually go and only give access to this onboarding account to onboard resources. It can't go change existing ones. It can't go create or manage other Azure resources. So the example here with servers, it can only onboard a new Arc server. You can also pick and choose the tags that you want to come on that machine by default. Of course, if you have policies in Azure that enforce your tag governance, those will apply as well as soon as that resource is created. And then lastly, you're presented with the script. From here, it's up to you how you want to run that on all your servers. So typically we see customers have some tool that they prefer to use. It might be something like Group Policy or Microsoft Endpoint Configuration Manager. Could be Ansible in the Linux world. Or if you're looking at multi-cloud and the cloud you're deploying with, like say AWS, has a custom script extension capability where you can go and actually run a script directly on a VM in that cloud, you could integrate this with a tool like Terraform or that cloud's native SDK to go and run this script on those machines. You only got to do this once. Once the onboarding happens, it's very quick and it's non-interactive if you use a service principle. Then that machine will be onboarded to Azure, and we can see here in the portal that it is the one I just onboarded is now showing up in my resource group and it's ready for management from the cloud. Now, the way we like to talk about Arc servers in particular is that this should be the first and only thing that you need to go and manually onboard to Azure. Once it shows up in Azure, you can leverage the rest of the Arc capabilities like extensions to go and onboard to other Azure services, which might also need an agent or an extension on that machine. But from there on out, Arc will handle it for you. So we're the first one you need to get on that machine. And from there, it's easy sailing through the Azure portal policy and command line tools.
Now, this makes it super easy to onboard resources at scale. Doesn't matter where they're running. If they're running on my on-premises system, running on different hypervisor, physical machines, or even in other cloud providers, right? It makes it super, super simple. And from there on, I'm then able to actually take advantage of the Azure management services, which I then can go out and enable for that resources. So that is pretty cool. And I'm sure now a lot of people are interested into Azure Arc. So Ryan, where can they find more?
Yeah, if you're interested in the onboarding scenario in particular, there's no better place to start than the Azure Arc Jumpstart. This is a collection of scenarios that are specific to all kinds of common environments our customers are running in. So there are sample scripts for running onboarding for AWS. There's sample scripts for onboarding a fleet of VMware VMs. And, you know, we're going to keep updating this content over time to cover a lot of common scenarios. Or if you already have preferred tooling, then you just need to get access to that script, you can generate it today in the Azure portal or head over to our documentation where you can learn more about how that script is generated, what it's doing, and how to modify it for your own needs.
That is great. Thank you, Ryan. And again, if you want to learn more about building hybrid applications or managing hybrid and multi-cloud environments, check out our Cloud Adoption Framework and the Azure Architecture Center.